secured a great victory for the South. Shortly thereafter, I received a note from Colonel Jordan, and I shall never forget the words in it. Our president and our general direct me to thank you. We rely upon you for further information. The Confederacy owes you a debt. You can imagine I was proud, but perhaps a little too proud, and not careful enough. For I began to notice, everywhere I went, there was someone following me. A short, squat man with a beard. Sometimes my friend Lily and I would double back and surprise him on the streets. We thought it was a game, but I could not have been more wrong. For his name was Alan Pinkerton, the chief of Mr. Lincoln's detective police. And on the 23rd of August, 1861, as I was returning from a promenade with a certain influential diplomat, I saw that Mr. Pinkerton waiting on my doorstep. I passed a friend on the street and I said, I fear I am to be arrested. It is so. I will raise my handkerchief to my lips. And you must warn all our friends not to come to my home, for I knew they would be in danger also. I had a message on my person, which I destroyed, and thus prepared, went forth to meet my fate. Are you Mrs. Greenow? Said Mr. Pinkerton as I approached my door. I am. I have come to arrest you, said he. By what authority? And he muttered something about sufficient verbal authority from the Departments of War and State. The Department of State being, of course, my former friend, Mr. Seward. I raised my handkerchief to my lips, watched my friend on my corner speed off to warn the others, and then turning my attention again to Mr. Pinkerton, I said, sir, I have no power to resist you. But had I been inside my home, and had I my pistol with me, I should know what to do with it. From that moment on, I became a prisoner, and my little daughter Rose also. She, who had been on a flowery path of girlhood, was forced to hear keys grating in prison locks and the rattle of muskets in the hallways of her once happy home. You may say what you will against me, but there is none more innocent than that child. And what government would confine a child in prison? One must look to the age of Nero or Caligula for a precedent. Everyone who came to my home was seized, questioned, searched. I was also searched by a creature called the female detectress Ellen. And I was forced to remove every one of my garments until I stood only in my linen, that she might examine every one of them for treasonable correspondence. And they found nothing, for on the first night, these detective police availed themselves of my amply stocked cellar, and while they were all inebriated, I destroyed everything of consequence in my library. They are brigands and thugs, nothing more, these agents of Mr. Pinkerton. My home became my prison. And yet, I was still able to communicate with my friends in Richmond. When my friend Mrs. Phillips was arrested and confined in my attic with her daughters, she was rather swiftly released, because her husband was a dear friend of the beanpole. As Mrs. Phillips was packing her belongings, I gave her a ball of pink yarn. She had never seen it before, but she did not question it, being a clever woman. That yarn unwound itself all the way to Richmond. And Mr. Davis found something of interest at the center. You may well imagine it infuriated Mr. Pinkerton that I was still communicating with my friends. And so I was taken from my home and confined in a still worse prison, the old Capitol. Curiously, that building had once been the very place where my Aunt Mary had her boarding house, and where I had attended Mr. Calhoun in his final illness. I sat once more in the very room where I had heard him say, I have lived in advance of my time, but you in yours will see the fulfillment of my prophecies. And I knew he was right, though not even Mr. Calhoun could have foreseen that I would be imprisoned for the sake of the Southern States. My little girl, too, was kept in that prison. And day after day, I kept a diary of all the injustices committed against us. I have it here, and I hope someday to publish it. At first, my hand was strong and firm. But as the days passed, and the weeks became months, I wrote smaller and smaller, for I knew they would not give me more paper if I used it all. And here we have May 18th. A senatorial committee have just visited the prison. I cannot understand precisely the object of it, although certainly not meant for the benefit of the prisoners. Senator Wilson was brought to see me. He who had once been my friend. I had very little to say to him. I was also visited while I was in prison by Mr. Stanton, afterwards a member of Mr. Lincoln's cabinet. He had no idea at that time of the position he was about to be raised to, neither did I. I asked him if he might represent me at trial if it ever came to that, but he had no interest in it. I was, however, brought before the committee for the trial of state prisoners, one of whom was my former friend, General Dix. When I was questioned by them, they asked me if I had conveyed information to the Confederate Army. And I told them, just as I told you, that had I freely received such information, I had every right to convey it to my friends. And they so angered me, these insolent gentlemen, that I said to them, I am a Southern woman. And I thank God not a drop of Yankee blood has ever polluted my veins. All I have ever loved and honored has been in the South, and it should be the most natural thing in the world for me to aid my country. And so I was sent once more back to my prison to mother in myself. My little girl became ill. I watched her once rosy cheeks grow pale. She would sit upon my knee night after night and say, Mama, tell me a story. And I would beguile her with the most improbable legends to try to take her mind off all she was suffering. When she fell ill, I insisted that my own doctor be sent for, but they sent instead the prison doctor. Now, thanks to the kind auspices of the one gentleman I met among the Union soldiers, Lieutenant Sheldon, I still had my pistol with me, though it was not loaded. And when that prison doctor, who was surely not a doctor, for he knew nothing of Latin and even less of medicine, came into our cell, I leveled my pistol at him and I said, touch my child at your peril, sir. You are no gentleman thus to insult a lady. And he fled. Shortly afterwards, a much more beautiful doctor came. And thankfully, my rose recovered. I do not know what I should have done if she had not. I began to think that so long as the war endured, I would never be free, that it was their intention to attempt to break my spirit by keeping me entirely confined in that prison. I was not even allowed to take exercise in the yard. But one time I did, the market cart came in, and it was my friend Charlie driving, so I leapt up beside him, took the reins, and drove around as fast as I could, shouting, I'm off for Dixie! It's a wonder they did not shoot me on the spot. But I was not permitted to take exercise after that again. Finally, in June of 62, after nearly a year of imprisonment, I was told by Mr. Superintendent Ward of the prison that I was to be sent south. I was afraid of this. But what could I do? I dressed Rose and myself in the best gowns we had left to us. and we walked hand in hand around the prison, saying goodbye to the other prisoners who had become our friends. They'd been so good to Rose, giving her little pieces of fruit, carving toys for her. The food was terrible. We were fed mostly beans and fat junk, and once a piece of chicken so old and tough it must have been the cock that crowed thrice to wake Peter, for we could not get our teeth through it. Then we were taken into the prison yard, where a carriage was waiting, so they said to take us salad. But ere I entered the carriage, I asked one of the soldiers who was to be our escort, "Sir, on your honor, not as one of Mr. Lincoln's men, but as a gentleman, what are your orders? Am I to be taken to another prison, or to some point within the Confederacy?" And he was a gentleman, for he answered promptly and clearly, "Madam, I am to take you first to Fortress Monroe." And there my heart sank, for I thought I might be imprisoned there. But he continued, "And from thence, onward to the Confederacy." So Rose and I left Washington, and we do not know if we shall ever see our home again. In Baltimore, though my name was erased from the hotel ledger, still the people of my own state learned that I was there, and they gathered on the platform of the train, waving their handkerchiefs and calling, "God bless you!" And I knew that the hearts of the people of Maryland could never be stamped out with the iron heel, as Senator Wilson of Massachusetts had boasted he would do. We were taken by ship to Virginia. All that time, I had this shawl round my shoulders, and under it, a flag that I had made in my time in prison for the great and glorious General Beauregard. As I set foot upon the soil of Virginia, and bade farewell to my captors, I considered letting the shawl fall and allowing my guards to see what I wore around my shoulders as a carrier aspect. But I did remember that I was still within rifle range. That flag now flies above General Beauregard's troops, and I was so fortunate to meet him in Charleston some 2 months ago. Mr. Davis also came to call upon me as soon as I reached Richmond. I saw in his face that the war had aged him greatly, and I could see in the way that he looked at me that he saw the many cares and struggles and the cost of my imprisonment. As he bent over my hand, he said, "Madam, but for you, we would have had no victory at Manassas." And those words of his were enough to repay me for all I had suffered. Now, Mr. Davis and Mr. Benjamin have such a sad story. They know I can be remarkable in prison, and so it is their intention to send me to Europe, to England and France, to plead the cause of the Confederacy. If either one of those nations would recognize our independence, as happened in the War of the Revolution, the war would be over in about a week. But England waits for France, and France for England, and they both do. Mr. Davis knows that I can be remarkably persuasive, and he hopes that I will do something there. Besides, I have a great desire to meet the Emperor of the French, Napoleon III, a man whom I admire immensely. And so I will go. I know it is dangerous to run the blockade, but I will take Rose with me. That poor child has suffered enough. I will enroll her in a school in France until the end of the war, but she may come home to a free and peaceful South. I have spoken very freely to you. More freely than perhaps I ought. For I am aware that the bean hole is here today. And I am aware also that where he goes, very often, are the brigands, thugs, and minions of Mr. Pinkerton. So I would ask you this. May I trust you to keep my secret? My very life may be in your heart. Thank you. But as for myself, come with me. Even if it should cost me my life, so long as there is breath in my body, I shall do whatever I can to aid my country in this, our struggle for freedom.